Well, the ratio on this video is probably going to be pretty bad, but I mean, look, somebody's got to say it, folks. Somebody has got to say it. But before I even begin to speak about anything, let's just take a moment collectively as the online left to just take a deep breath. Let's just try to chill. If you have time, commit yourself to try to go outside and touch grass, because I promise you, being terminally online 100% of the time is not good for your health. It's not good for your physical health. It's also not good for your mental health. I speak from experience. Now, unfortunately for me, the best that I can do is touch synthetic grass here. But even just doing this, like, this makes me feel better. Every once in a while, we just have to step back, take a deep breath, and try to recalibrate. Understand that our emotions, even if they are justifiable, can drive us into irrational territories. And being irrational for too long leads to situations like we're currently dealing with right now. And I'm not necessarily even sure how to describe the situation that I want to talk about. So my thoughts are a little bit scattered here. But I'll just say it, the online left is a complete disaster since Bernie Sanders ended his 2020 campaign. It's a mess. If you log on to Twitter right now, you will probably immediately explode in anger. You'll start doom scrolling. You'll start spiraling. And it's just a mess right now. And I think that every once in a while, we have to remind ourselves, what are we doing? Why are we doing what we're doing? And how do we make ourselves more effective? And to even suggest that perhaps maybe the left collectively online anyways has gone astray is in and of itself controversial. But understand that a lot of what's happening on Twitter right now, all of the leftist infighting, it's pretty insular. Most normal people, thankfully, most leftists even in the United States and internationally, have no idea what's going on Twitter. They have no idea about the amount of infighting. And thank God, like, if any of my normie liberal family members saw what's going on Twitter, they think that we're more unhinged as leftists than they already do, right? It's already bad enough trying to convince them to support more socialistic policies, socialist politicians like Bernie Sanders and AOC. But if you log onto Twitter, it's like, holy fucking shit. People are losing their minds. And I'm not going to get too specific, because if I name names, that I'm literally feeding into it further and giving the people who are trying to drive instability and anger in the left exactly what they want. Because unfortunately, there are a lot of nefarious individuals and opportunistic individuals who try to drive a wedge between people, because that is exactly what gets them views and clicks, right? So if I were to make a video titled "Fuck Kyle Kulinski." I love Kyle. But if I made a video titled "Fuck Kyle Kulinski," that would probably get like 50,000, 100,000 views. Because people love drama. The algorithm feeds into drama. So if you can keep people in a sustained state of anger, then that gets them coming back. Eventually, you cultivate this audience where they're in this, your viewers are in this parasocial relationship with you, and they have to tune in to find out what to be angry about. And there sure is a lot of things to be angry about. I'm constantly in a state of perpetual anger. But oftentimes, if you're just in that state of anger nonstop, it will eat away at your brain. And again, every once in a while, you have to recalibrate. So we're getting to a point on the left where I think that we all have to be a little bit introspective, myself included, and recalibrate. So I'm trying to figure out where I want to go with this, because it's like stepping on a bunch of fucking landmines. But let me just say that the squad, AOC, Cori Bush, these individuals are not your enemies. I think that it is perfectly justifiable if you are feeling disillusioned with members of Congress and the squad, even because they praise Joe Biden far too much and go along with the establishment far too much. I understand that. I tend to have that criticism and agree with these folks. Having said that, though, to make them public enemy number one does nothing for the left. It only makes us look unhinged to constantly go after somebody who is like the closest to us, ideologically speaking. The squad is not our enemies. And I shouldn't have to say that. You can be disillusioned with the squad, but it's gotten so bad that people are already pre-canceling Nina Turner, who hasn't even been elected yet, who would be one of the strongest fighters. But people just like look for every little thing to be angry at, right? So there were the incredible Medicare for All marches that took place, and there were some terminally online individuals who were trying to attack Nina Turner because she wasn't there. But Nina Turner has less than a week until her election takes place. So it's really important that she's out in Ohio on the ground canvassing people to go door to door. Now, could she have tweeted about the march? Sure. Sure, that's a perfectly valid criticism. But to like totally write off Nina Turner as an individual and just automatically assume that she is a sellout is kind of absurd. And you have to understand who the real enemies are. You can criticize your allies in Congress, but they shouldn't be public enemy number one. Like, if you demonize AOC and the squad and you're disappointed in them, okay. But perhaps direct your ire at the individuals who are actually holding us back. Even if AOC, so for example, there's a lot of people that were angry that AOC didn't tweet about the Medicare for All marches. And I think that that's reasonable, right? It would have been great if she used her platform to do that. But that doesn't mean that AOC is a sellout. And just me saying that AOC isn't a sellout is in and of itself a cancelable offense. But you have to understand, people, that AOC, even if she did everything that we wanted her to do, the issue is that AOC is just one member of Congress, right? AOC doesn't have some magical Medicare for All button that she can press that immediately gives us Medicare for All. That's not the way that it works, unfortunately. I wish that it were that easy, but that's not actually the world that we're living in. She can't do that. So even if AOC all of a sudden became even more radical, took the advice of the online left, the terminally online individuals, myself included, I'm in this category, and she became a communist and like went full like, fuck the Democratic Party, fuck Nancy Pelosi. Still, that would be awesome to see, but would that get us any closer to Medicare for All? No, because we have to really tend to focus on the centers of power. And this is why I say we have to recalibrate, because every once in a while, our anger drives us to irrational places to where we see someone who's actually an ally to us as not just an enemy, but public enemy number one. And the reason why AOC is so hated by the online left after being loved by her is because there are some individuals with very large followings that get extra views and clicks when they shit on someone like AOC. Why? Well, because there's already a substantial portion of the online left who's disappointed in AOC. So you have all of those people, you know, automatically clicking when they see a video demonizing AOC. But on top of that, you get a lot of right-wingers who have gone out of their way to demonize AOC. So you get left-wingers and right-wingers all congregating to these videos where, you know, leftists shit on AOC. And then all of a sudden, it's like, wow, these views are great. That's the feedback loop. You know, you give them what they want. They give you what you want in exchange, views and clicks. And then you start doing it again and again. And with time, eventually, you start to cultivate this perception that AOC is public enemy number one. When there are people in Congress who actually have power. I'm talking about Hakeem Jeffries. I'm talking about Nancy Pelosi, Chuck Schumer. I'm talking about Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin. I'm talking about the Republicans, the Koch network, who's literally fighting even a Medicaid expansion or a Medicare expansion, excuse me, that Bernie Sanders is pushing for. Bernie Sanders is fighting tooth and nail to lower the eligibility age for Medicare from 65 to 60. And also he's trying to expand benefits. So it includes dental, hearing, and vision. I almost went dental and like pointed to my eyes. But you get the point, right? I'm trying to do Bernie's thing. That's what he usually does. Anyways, And the Koch network is literally funding an AstroTurf campaign against Bernie Sanders. So understand that there are a lot of enemies in politics and your anger is justified. But if you're not directing it at the right people, then you're not going to affect change. That's just a fact. And it's frustrating because people are in no-win positions. So to go back to the Medicare for All March, which was great, by the way, which I talked about on my show. And side note, I got lambasted for not talking about it when I actually did talk about it. This is like what I mean of people just like looking for reasons to be mad at one another on the left when we're not each other's enemies. We're actually allies. But Cori Bush showed up to the Medicare for All march, which is phenomenal. To have a sitting member of Congress endorse these nationwide marches, that's really, really incredible. But you had some people online attacking her. One person filmed a video, and I won't name this person because this is a really small account, so I don't want to direct harassment towards them. But one person was really mad that Cori Bush showed up to the march, and she said that she didn't support force the vote because it was overly divisive. Now, I supported force the vote, contrary to popular belief, because I thought it was a good tactic. I wanted to see a floor vote on Medicare for All, even if that wouldn't actually lead to Medicare for All being codified into law. I think it was a useful, you know, theatrical tactic, but it didn't happen. But it's a mere disagreement of political tactics to get us closer to Medicare for All. And the fact that Cori Bush dared to say, well, I don't support it because it's divisive, then that person attacked Cori Bush, basically proving her right. And then after that, subsequently, Cori Bush was attacked by other individuals saying, oh, well, she doesn't even care about Medicare for All. She didn't tweet about it, and she just showed up for a photo op. It's like, okay, folks, this is why I say we have to recalibrate. We have to go outside and touch grass. They're in this no-win position. Members of the squad are in a no-win position to where nothing they do can prove that they are worthy. Nina Turner hasn't even been elected, and people are already brushing her off. She's in a fight for her life. The establishment certainly thinks that Nina Turner is a threat, but yet you have some people who are terminally online, primarily on Twitter, who are like already saying it doesn't matter if she's elected or not, because, you know, she's not going to fight, so we might as well get a corporate Democrat in there who's being funded by the pro-Israel lobby. That's not what they're saying, but I mean, that's effectively what the outcome will be. And it's really frustrating to me because I don't even know what to do going forward. This is what happens when there's no leadership on the left. This is why I think that the end of Bernie Sanders' campaign has been so damaging to the left, because when there's no leadership there to kind of guide people's anger, you know, a vacuum opens up and opportunistic actors kind of like pounce, and they try to direct people in ways that get them disempowered and, you know, leave them perpetually angry and powerless. And that's a real issue here on the left. And so the People's Party, for example, they did a march outside of AOC's office, and a lot of really wonderful people showed up to this, right? Susan Sarandon, Christian Smalls, Savage Joy, people who are great, well-intentioned people. But the People's Party could be using the organizational power that they have to fight someone like Nancy Pelosi or people on powerful committees blocking Medicare for All from even getting a floor vote. But instead, they protest an ally. And it's frustrating to see this because it makes us look unhinged. Like, I'm thinking of like my normie family members who are MSNBC liberals. If they found out about this, they think, see, you're unhinged. You Bernie supporters are fucking, you're attacking your own. So it's best that we just disregard you. And the thing that worries me about this is it looks like it's a PR stunt for the People's Campaign, not to pick on them, but I kind of am. It's like they have an incentive to demonize members of the squad to, you know, push people into the People's Party. Now, we already have a Green Party, but we need a People's Party, according to them, because the Green Party is, you know, too socialistic. I'm not necessarily sure what the rationale is. I had Nick Brana on my program a really long time ago to talk about like the draft Bernie movement, and that didn't go anywhere. But the issue is that if you suggest to people, all right, the Democratic Party is incapable of reform, you might be right about that. I think we really have to have an inside-outside strategy. I think that is absolutely crucial. So the existence of third parties, even if they can't necessarily win power, I do think they are important pressure points on individuals from the inside, including AOC. That's great. So, but I mean, what I'm speaking to here is really the opportunism that I'm seeing and the unseriousness of the People's Party. Because if I'm a third party, like if I'm in control of the People's Party, and this isn't just like some party to exert outside pressure on insiders, and we actually want to run candidates, field candidates, and win and actually get power, here's what is going to be my number one priority. And I talked about this in the video where I covered the People's Party. Electoral reform. it's extremely frustrating to me because for years I've said to people, if you want a third party, you need electoral reform because we have a first past the post, winner take all majoritarian system. It's Duverger's law. It always holds. And if we were going to break up the two-party duopoly by force and without getting electoral reform, it would have happened in 2016. Hillary Clinton versus Donald Trump. But it still didn't happen. Jill Stein got like barely 1% of the vote. So if you want a third party to actually get power because you believe the Democratic Party is not capable of change, okay, that may be a valid point. But you need electoral reform. You can't just say, fuck the squad, support the People's Party, if you have no plan whatsoever to change the electoral system. And ranked choice voting is a very easy thing to do that. It would help. It wouldn't necessarily get us, you know, multiple parties. But you have to understand that there are actual bills. And unfortunately, Don Byers hasn't reintroduced this, but there's the Fair Representation Act. It was H.R. 4000 in the 2019-2020 legislative session. And this would actually move us closer towards proportional representation. And the people on the left who are really adamant about going the third party route said nothing about this. And I've begged people to support electoral reform. I want us to be a multi-party system. And that's difficult when you have a presidential and not a parliamentary system like Canada has. But we can't do that just by having an extra party because there are already hundreds of third parties in the United States. But this issue has become so contentious because people are rightfully angry at the Democratic Party, feeling perhaps justifiably so that it won't be reformed or can't be reformed, that anyone who dares to run in the Democratic Party, they're not worth a damn. And hence the reason why Nina Turner has been disregarded by many people. But the problem with that is if you just have one extra party to add to the hundreds of third parties that already exist, you're not doing much. And the way that we actually enact change is by having power. And so, unfortunately, opportunistic individuals, they're leading people towards this path of perpetual anger and disempowerment. The People's Party might end up putting electoral reform on their agenda. They might put pressure on Don Byers to reintroduce the Fair Representation Act. Perhaps they even pressure AOC, which would be an incredible idea, to support the Fair Representation Act because she didn't co-sponsor that legislation, which I think she should support because it's good legislation. But they're not doing that right now. So at this state, if the People's Party simply runs candidates just in addition to the Republican and the Democrat, well, unless you're in a state like California, where you have a jungle primary system, where you have the top two vote getters make it to the general election, you're not going to get anyone elected. So really what we have to do as leftists is build power, not disempower ourselves. But if we are constantly attacking the only allies we have in Congress, putting them in no-win positions where regardless of what they do, show up or don't show up to our marches, we still shit on them, we're in a constant state of disempowerment, and we are absolutely serving the corporate Democratic Party who wants the left to be divided. We have basically divided ourselves into oblivion to where the online left is now unrecognizable. And again, thankfully, this is all very insular and a lot of people don't recognize what's happening on Twitter. But what we're doing here is we are killing ourselves by dividing ourselves and even questioning one another, where every little thing we do or don't do is irredeemable. So getting back to me like getting called out for not talking about the Medicare for All march, I did talk about it. I brought on one of the organizers. It was on the first episode of Dystopian Times, one of the first segments that I released for Dystopian Times. And I talked about it and I uploaded that as a segment. It was like over 10 minutes long. And we talked about the necessity of healthcare. But people who don't even watch anymore, which is fine, preferable if you're a cancerous individual, because I don't want you in my audience if you're toxic, but they are already like attacking me because I didn't talk about something I already talked about. And if I do talk about it, then it's like, well, you didn't talk about it enough. We put each other in no-win situations. And this is not about me, but I'm speaking to my experience. Or, you know, people online will say something and it's like, oh, well, you know what? You must be a CIA plant. You must be an operative for the Republican Party or the Democratic Party. And we're so suspicious of people. We're so angry at our own peers who have the same goals as us, that I just have to tell people, stop take a deep breath. Let's all chill. Let's all recalibrate. Let's all go outside and touch grass. And whenever we get to a point to where we are in a constant state of anger, where people are, you know, attacking one another and driving more of a wedge between the online left that already exists, stop. Don't participate in it. I took the week off from my show last week, and I felt really good. It was good for, like, my mental health. And then immediately, like, coming back, I log on to Twitter, and it's like, oh, I feel depressed and hopeless again, because there's nothing but, like, hatred and vitriol online. And again, part of this is that, like, the vacuum, the leadership vacuum left open by Bernie, you know, after his campaign, people who are nefarious, or perhaps not even nefarious, just opportunistic people, seized on that leadership vacuum. They tried to take up the mantle, and it's literally exactly what, like, the right wants and the corporate Democrats want. Us fighting each other and, like, giving Joe Manchin and Joe Biden a pass. Folks, we seem unreasonable. If you log on to Twitter, people seem unhinged. People are attacking their allies for dumb reasons. Vote shaming, when I thought that leftists don't like that, where it's like, oh, you supported Joe Biden, so, like, you're literally a war criminal. I mean, imagine if somebody who wasn't terminally online saw the discourse that takes place on Twitter. They would rightfully think that we're batshit fucking insane, because that's the way that we seem. So I don't really care if this pisses people off. It needs to be said. Chill out. Stop feeding into the anger. Stop infighting. Stop being accusatory of anyone who dares to vocalize any disagreement with you whatsoever. Calm down, recalibrate, and recognize who the real enemies are. While we fight each other, corporate Democrats like Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema, they get a pass. They get to block voting rights that would actually help democracy as Republicans try to kill it. Republicans get a pass as they literally spiral further into delusions and become more conspiratorial, more anti-vax. We have to calm down and stop fighting each other over every fucking thing, for the love of God. Just breathe, recalibrate, recenter yourself. And remember that every once in a while, being angry, which is justifiable, it can lead us to a prolonged state of irrationality, which is not healthy, which gets us away from the trajectory that we should be on. It moves us away from our goals. And every once in a while, if we log off, remind ourselves why we're even talking about politics, it's because we care about these issues, then that will be it'll be better. It'll be better for all of us, better for the movement. But for me to even say this, people will assume I'm, like, in some camp online. I'm a TYT sellout who is, like, getting my marching orders from Cenk. I've heard that too. People, for the love of God, we have to stop doing this. We have to stop with the drama and the infighting. The people who want this to go on aren't doing it because it's actually beneficial for the left. They're doing it because it's beneficial for themselves, for their pockets. And I'm not going to name names. I'm not going to feed into that so I can start a new wave of drama. I'm not going to do that. But what I am saying is that individually, you as a viewer, as a Twitter user, which I hope you're not, can make the decision unilaterally to try to do better. I've certainly tried. I've tried to log off and use Twitter less. I've tried to not engage in infighting. And when I see somebody who I disagree with, I try to, like, engage with them in good faith and explain to them why I don't agree with their position And sometimes, you know, it'll move them to my side. Other times they'll like immediately shit themselves and start frothing at the mouth because they don't want to hear anything that I'm saying. And that's fine. You can't reach everyone, but the best that we can do is police ourselves in a way and make sure that what we're contributing to political discourse isn't actually a net negative. Rather, it's a positive. So look, it's not like I'm above the fray. I'm guilty of infighting too. But every once in a while, we have to recenter ourselves and recalibrate and breathe. Let's breathe. And again, touching grass can do wonders. That's all. Now dislike the video, you fucks, because I know you're going to do it.
Shut the fuck up! Ideas. Recovery mode, my brain ideas. Recovery mode, my brain ideas.